Hi, my name is Robert Feranek. I'm from FEDEVEL Academy. And in this video, we will go through this design, which is done by a junior hardware design engineer. And I will point out a few things around vias. I will point out the things what I would maybe do differently or which I would improve, and I will explain how I would do it and why I would do it. So I really hope you will find this video useful, and let's do it. The very first thing what I would like to talk about is this. Now I'm curious, do you know what I mean? One ground via per 1, 2, 3 ground pins. Or this. One power via per 1, 2 power pins. 1, 2, 3, 4 power pins, 2 power vias. This is not how I do PCB layout. Always when I do PCB layout, I will try to place at least one via per power pin or one via per ground pin. That's how I do layout. Especially in this stage of the layout, when you are just starting, do it this way, okay? A little bit later, I know there may be some places which are really, really busy on your PCB. For example, under a processor, and you may need to remove some of the vias. So in these places, you can see there is no one via per power pin because there is no place. But initially, at this stage of the layout, I will place it everywhere. And then during layout, I will remove these vias. And I'm talking about this because when I received this layout from the junior engineer, I pointed this out, and next day, I got, again, same thing, connecting multiple paths and one via. I understand because it's simple and it's quick, and also for some components, it is not really super important to have one via per ground pin or one via per power pin for pull-ups or for pull-downs. This is not really necessary, but the best way how to connect these pins is to place one via per power pin, one via per ground pin. And what is really best on this technique is that you can very simply explain this to anyone, even people who are starting with layout, and they will do it properly. They don't have to understand really what is happening on the PCB, and they will do the layout properly. When we have a look at this place, this is a board-to-board connector, and you can see this is the place where, again, multiple ground pins are connected through one via. This would be, this layout, what you can see here, this is not a good way how to connect these ground pins. Why? Do you know why? For example, one reason are return currents. When a signal flows through this signal, through this pin which is here, there is always a return current. Okay? So how this return current is going to flow for this signal? Ideally, the return current should flow as close as possible to this signal. Ideally, we would like to have the ground via here, but it is here. That's not the best way how to do layout for these pins which are here. So very simple rule, when you place one via per ground pin, when you place one via per power pin, you will do it properly, even if you don't know exactly what is happening on your board. You will always do it properly. It is always better to place the or to do layout this way, okay? It doesn't mean it's not going to work when you connect all these pins together and place only one via, but this is the best way how to connect it, okay? And as I say, there are places, if it's like very busy, you can use one via per multiple pins, but only later, when you see that there is no other option, then remove the via and connect the pins together. I'm sure you understand, okay? It's a very simple rule and it's very easy to follow. Just don't be lazy. When you will be connecting multiple paths to one via, then if possible, don't do it this way. Okay, maybe you would like to connect it this way. Use this kind of star connection, so there is direct connection between the path and the via. This is some kind of series connection, and especially for like higher currents or high speed signals, there some of these currents flowing, for example, to this last path, they may influence the currents flowing to the other paths. Okay, so this is the preferred way, maybe how you would like to connect these pins. If possible, don't use this. When we are speaking about connecting a path to a via, this is what I would like to highlight, because I've seen this junior engineer placing the vias and connecting vias with paths different ways. So this is what I normally do. I always consider how the current will flow. So for example, this is a 1.8 power supply pin. So this from this pin, 1.8 volt is coming out into our board. And notice where I place the via, how this pin is connected with the via. The track goes through this capacitor. Okay? So everything what flows from this path, it has to go through this capacitor. A different way how this can be connected is, for example, place the via somewhere here. This is something what I may do, because sometimes there is no space to place the vias the way as we would like to have them. So sometimes I can do it this way, but if possible, as I mentioned, I really like to connect these paths with vias through the capacitors. And this is same for when you are placing decoupling capacitors. So basically this would be then power supply, this would be decoupling capacitor, this would be a pin on your chip, and all the currents which would flow inside of the chip, they would flow through the capacitor. Okay? I wanted to mention this because I noticed that people, they are just placing these vias anywhere they want and maybe not thinking about how currents will flow between the vias and the paths. So it may be useful to think about this. Different example, very interesting one. We are going to have a look at this specific version of the PCB, or a revision of the PCB, and we are going to have a look at audio chip or audio chip and decoupling capacitors for this audio chip. I'm going to open schematic and watch this. So for example, we are going to have a look at this C209 capacitor. It is this one, which is here. And it looks like connected some kind of correctly, yeah? Because there is via, which is connected directly to 1.8 power plane. Then from the via, there is track, which goes through the path of the capacitor and it goes to the pin of the audio chip. Now, ignore that this VI is a little bit close to the pad. We will speak about this a little bit later. But what is really interesting is this ferrite bit, FB2, placed on this track between the capacitor and the pin. I would never do it this way. FB2 is this ferrite bit which is here. And this can be connected differently. So ideally, we would like to maybe place a via directly to 1.8 power plane. Then we would like to have a ferrite bit and then direct connection from the ferrite bit through this C206 capacitor path to the CPVDD path. Here on this layout, ferrite bit is placed in the middle between this C209 capacitor and this path. And here is actually a via, which is not really necessary to have it on this path. There can be direct connection. This is how it was improved in different revision of the board, which is a little bit better, but it is still not what I would use. You can see, oops, I'm going to move it a little bit like this. You can see that now the ferrite bit has been moved a little bit. So there is direct connection from the ferrite bit through this C206 capacitor, which is here, to the audio chip. There is a connection between via through the C209 capacitor to the chip, but they are both sharing one via, and maybe what I would do, I would maybe just simply copy this, I would disconnect it here and place the via here, okay, something like this. So each of these has its own via. This power rail will have its own via, and this power rail, which is here, will have its own via. I know maybe it looks like very small things, but you know, when your PCB is large and there are many tracks, many vias, many components, everything what you can improve, it may help to improve the quality of your PCB, because there will be a lot of things, a lot of these small things on bigger PCBs or in bigger projects. So improve everything what you can. Here is something what I would like to show you. Let's go back here. I'm going to zoom in and tell me what you see. We are going to speak about this capacitor and the vias. There is different number of vias on the plus side of the capacitor and here on the ground. Here are two vias, here is only one via. When you have components where you are expecting higher currents, you need to place multiple vias, but on both sides there is always return current. Okay, you cannot place 100 vias on this side and one via here. That's not going to help. You have to place same number of vias on plus side and same number of vias on the ground side of the capacitor. Two vias here, two vias here. You need to count how many vias you need based on the maximum current what you are going to draw from, or what you are going to need from this capacitor, okay? But you need to place it on both sides. Very important. I'm going to zoom in on this chip, which is here. It is a PCI Express clock chip. So it's a very important chip. And I'm not very happy how this ground vias and power vias and decoupling components are connected around this chip. Have a look. Here are some decoupling capacitors. They are sharing one ground via. Again, capacitor sharing ground via together with exposed path. Very important, when you have exposed path under your chip, have a look at the reference design. Have a look inside of datasheet. Sometimes you can connect the exposed path with the ground pins, which are here. Sometimes they will ask you to connect exposed path and these pins, which are here. Sometimes they will tell you that you should not connect these paths, which are here, directly with the exposed path. They will tell you should use a via. Okay, so be very, very careful. If you have exposed path and if you have ground pins around the chip, have a look how you can connect them. Okay, and I really will need to find a way how we can improve this via sharing around this chip. Not easy, but we will do it. Okay, that's the problem. Problem is making better layout, it requires some additional effort. It requires some time, additional work. It's not easy. That's one of the reasons why I think many layouts are not as good as they could be, because people just connect everything very quickly. They would like to make the layout very quickly, so they just do it somehow the fastest way as they could. But for important designs, it may be a problem. For important designs, you really should take some time and try to make the layout as good as possible. There is something else what I noticed on this PCB. I'm going to zoom in and have a look how close some of the vias are placed to path. Okay, this via is touching this path. This one is touching the path. This one is like really, really close. The hole is actually going inside of the path. Normally, I don't want to place vias like this. Normally, when I place vias, I place them the way they are not touching path. If you are using via in path technology, then you can place vias on the path. It's not a problem. However, if you are not using via in path technology, then in some cases, for example, when your vias are not tented, if there is no mask on the vias, or if your vias are empty, if they are not filled, then if you place these vias very close to a path, then the solder from the path can flow inside of the via. And because there will be less solder on the path, then the soldering quality between the component and the PCB may not be as good as you would expect. Okay, so if you place vias too close to path, it can influence soldering quality on your PCB. In some cases, I do place vias into exposed path, for example. You can do it, just be aware that some of the solder may go inside of the via. Okay, when you are placing vias, you would like to be sure that there is always solder mask between the hole and the path. If I go on layer 2, there is something else what I would like to show you. Notice how close these micro vias are placed. In this special case, maybe this rule, what we are going to talk about, it's not really important because these micro vias, they are on different layers. But I would like to point out that there is one special rule, there is one special limitation. When PCB is manufactured, there is something called minimum hole-to-hole clearance. And that's basically the minimum distance, how close the edges of holes can be on your PCB. And for standard PCBs, I think usually it's like 0.2 millimeter. That's 8 mils, I think. For micro vias, I believe it may be less, like 0.1 millimeter for mils. But you need to be aware of this because sometimes you may by accident place some holes too close to each other. You can Google about this. If you go, for example, on internet and when you find a PCB manufacturer website, let's say this one, this is the cheap PCB manufacturer. Here you can see minimum hole-to-hole clearance for different nets. So it's this distance between edge of the holes. It's 0.54 millimeter. That's a lot, okay? So be aware of this PCB manufacturing limitation. By the way, normally, when I would be creating this kind of connections, I would do it like this. I would not place the micro vias too close to each other, just a little bit further and use a small track. And then simply I would just always copy and place this small connection everywhere where I would need it. Okay, so I would not do it like this, I would do it like this. And when we are speaking about this minimum distance between two holes, I would like to speak a little bit about between minimum distance between the vias. Normally, theoretically, you can place them based on the minimum clearance. However, watch this. This here, on the top layer, there is memory. This is the processor. And when doing fan out of the memory, when placing these power and ground vias, you need to be careful how much space between the vias is there. Because ideally, you would like to place them the way that the copper can flow between the vias. If you notice in this region here, these vias, they are placed too close to each other. They are cutting plane on all the layers in this area. And you don't want to have this kind of holes in your planes. You would like to have the planes as solid as possible. So you need to improve this kind of layout. If I have a look, this is different version of the PCB. Here you can see how the vias were spread a little bit. So the quality of all the planes is now much better. There are still some holes, but there is no one big hole, as you can see here in this case. There is even better example, this one. Watch this. Here are all the vias placed all in one column, and there is huge hole in this ground plane, which is on layer 2. So what do we need to do with this? We have to spread these vias so the copper on this plane, it can flow between the vias. Okay? Be very careful when you are placing vias. You always would like to be sure the copper can flow between the vias. There is one more tip what I would like to mention in this video, and it is always, before you start drawing tracks in your PCB, place the vias first. This can save you a lot of time. I'm going to give you an example. Okay. Let's say, I'm going to switch off the colors. Let's say we are going to do layout for these differential pairs which are here. So as you can see, you start drawing the differential pairs, you will connect them and you will be like, oh, this is beautiful. It looks so nice, no? And after you connect all these differential pairs, you will start placing the vias. So you start placing vias here and you will need to redraw this track which is here. Then you will place some vias here and you have to redraw this track which is here. Then you will place some vias here and you suddenly have to redraw all the tracks here and this track and this one and also this one. It's going to take you a lot of time. Much, much better approach is to place all these vias first and only after that start drawing the tracks. Okay? And even when you start drawing these tracks, don't focus on how nice they will look. Initially, you only would like to know how to connect these tracks. Initially, your goal is to connect all the pins as quickly as possible. And only after you connect all the pins, only after that, start making all the layout nicer and better. That's how I do the layout. And that's how it will save you a lot of time. Okay? Don't spend time drawing something what you will redraw 10 or 20 or 50 times. Spend time trying to draw the way that you have to redraw the tracks as few times as possible. By the way, all the examples what we have seen in this video, they are all from the same board, but from different time, from different development stage. They are basically all from different revisions of the board. The board is being designed by a junior hardware design engineer, so it's a really good board to make some YouTube videos. And if you like this video, then I can make a different video and maybe point out also some other things what I had to correct or I had to explain to this engineer to make it differently. This board has not been finished yet, so if you have seen any weird tracks or any weird placement or something, you can just ignore it, okay? Everything on this board is going to be improved. And that's everything for today's video. If you would like to see the next part on the same topic, where I would be commenting different parts of the layout about this board, leave comments, okay? Let me know in the comments. If you like this kind of format, if you like this video, don't forget to press like button. If you would like to see all my future videos, then please subscribe. I know I keep telling this, but the number of subscribers is helping me a lot to create new and better videos. You will see when I will create the decoupling capacitor video, I'm putting a lot of information together. Creating this decoupling capacitor video, it would not be possible without you subscribing for my channel. Okay, so don't forget, like the video, subscribe, and thank you very much for watching. See you next time.